got our guy, our spy pilot. They've got their spy. We want you to negotiate the swap.
I'm an insurance lawyer.
Are you good at what you do?
This will be a first for the both of us.
You should be careful.
Do you know how people will look at us? The family of a man trying to free a traitor?
Every person matters.
Why aren't we hanging him? He's a spy!
We need to know what the Russian is telling you.
We're not having this conversation.
Don't go Boy Scout on me. We don't have a rule book here.
We call it the Constitution, and that's what makes us Americans.
What does a costume designer do?
All right. So, my job as a costume designer is, first of all, to read the script and represent the underlying design in the script. Portrayed by people. So we create, like, just as the production designer creates the physical world, I create the worlds for the people who live in those worlds. So my job is to tune in to all the elements that are on the page and tune into the vision of the director and production designer and director of photography and become part of that world that we are creating. And it's done through very extensive research. In case like of a movie like Bridge of Spies, we have thousands of pictures to support our process. That period of time, since it's based on a real story, that period of time was very well documented. The characters were extremely well documented. So it's our job to find that research. And by the time we step into the project, there's already a lot of information existing, but then we dive to a whole other dimension of looking for representation of each of the characters, all the historical figures, and the worlds that are being portrayed in the film. So after a substantial amount of time, and that varies between 3 weeks and a month, or 4 weeks, 5 weeks of research, that reality starts emerging. And then I choose the images to create a vocabulary for the film. And I feel like if it's soaked with reality, it resonates reality. And I create this language, vocabulary of language, and share it with all the parties. And that's when we decide the world, the limits of the world, which way we're going. Color, historical correctness, portrayal of characters. I give skin to the characters as they are being portrayed. So it becomes this collaboration between many different people of how is the human world represented.
What is the biggest misconception people have about what you do?
I think that people, I mean, it's interesting because when I work on contemporary films, it's 10 times more difficult than working on films that are set in period, because somehow period creates this barrier of immediate reaction from everybody. The biggest misconception is that people think that it's just, you know, pulling clothes and putting on people. If the costumes are right, nobody notices them. If they are done not faithful to the character, they stick out. And I think it's my job to make sure that they fit the characters and they fit the world that they are supposed to represent.
How soon are you on a movie and when do you leave?
I prep usually, it depends on the size of the film, but the prep is more or less 12 weeks before the filming. And it depends on the scope of the film, how long I remain. If there's two lead characters who wear the same outfits throughout the whole film, there is no need for me to be there. If we establish those worlds early on, and it's called establishing all the costumes, if those characters are established, there is no need for me to be there. In case of a movie like Bridge of Spies, we had endless worlds that we kept filming. So between the worlds in the States and the world in Germany, the representation of the court in Russia, those were so many different worlds that we were preparing those worlds as the movie continued filming. So I stayed till the very last day on the project, because at the very end of the film we were filming the Peshawar base, and that was a whole other world of creating the American military base. So and then our team, we had multiple teams of people working in New York, Germany, Poland, Los Angeles, and one person, the key person to this whole operation of making those worlds happen, which is in this case about 100 principals and about 4,000 extras, and we dress everybody head to toe. The one person who has to keep the organizational part of all those operations is like the key person. His name is wardrobe supervisor. In this film, Bridge of Spies, was this phenomenal, the best of the best wardrobe supervisor, David Davenport, who organized those multiple teams around the world. And I basically, as I was fitting all the principals, I was viewing each picture of all the extras being fit, because those fittings start weeks before they go on camera. And we have to have enough time, adequate time, to collect the stocks to have to dress people. Then we have teams of people fitting the people under my direction of what the looks are. And then those costumes need to be maintained and delivered to sets and dressed. So that on the day of this Russian court, our team starts hours before the filming starts to have hundreds of people ready for the day of shooting. So it's quite an elaborate structure of how do you get 400 people ready for a day of shooting, or how do you get 700 people ready for a day of shooting. So the stages are research, collecting of the stocks, physically dressing people, preparing the clothes, filming, and then again striking those costumes, returning them back to the proper costume houses, and that's how pretty much the world of costumes functions.
What is the collaboration process like with the director?
Each process with each director is very different. Some directors are extremely visual in their process of creating the vocabulary of the film. Some are less visual, so it's this communication that we have to develop with each other and find each other's language. Mr. Steven Spielberg is extremely visual. He knows exactly what he's looking at. So when I presented pictures of the, first I presented the design book with the ideas for the film, and he had very strong and very encouraging response to that design process. And then I showed him pictures from each fittings, and he had very clear ideas of what he loves, his favorites. I usually try to present two or three great options. Sometimes it's just one option because it's obvious that it's just the only one option that he calls for. And under such a precise direction, also the script was so clear. Like, my job in the end is to read the script and deliver what's on the page. And when it's done with all the elements being taken into consideration of all the parties, it's almost like we are all on one train going in the same direction. We all deliver worlds that are meant for that storytelling. So, I don't know.
Can you compare and contrast two directors that are sort of polar opposites? Or are they very similar? Are all directors very similar?
No, I feel like all the directors that I've worked with, it's, you know, I feel like if the character is very well developed, the story is, and if the story is very powerful and well told, my job is very easy. So I feel like I've had the privilege of working with really great directors where they have such a strong ideas of the character, they are driven so much by a storytelling, then I just deliver the elements of what the story calls for. So they are, each time is different, but it's just from my experience of the recent years, I've been very lucky of working with great directors.
Are there other film departments you have to collaborate with?
I have to collaborate with a production designer. We collaborate very closely. Because in the end, our jobs are we are so interwoven with each other. Like, we live within the spaces that the production designer creates. So we share research and we share fitting photos. We check with each other very frequently of how our worlds are going to coexist with each other. We collaborate very closely with the director of photography, because the level of how we're going to see things and to what degree things are going to be shown in a close-up, which calls for attention of detail, or in this huge anamorphic lens scope where you see the whole world, that's just a different perspective, whether you create a detail or whether you create a much bigger scope of seeing.
What's the hardest part of your job and the most rewarding?
There is no golden answer for that, because there is, each job is so dramatically different from each other. I feel like I've been doing this for quite a few years, and each time I think that that's what's exciting about each job. Each job, I feel like it's completely new vocabulary. I mean, I'm lucky that it's a new vocabulary, because it's very exciting to do new vocabulary each time, because each story is different from each other. So we just like, I mean, I always compare, it's like we enter this capsule of this environment and we have to learn it really, really well and portray this reality. So, you know, I did Black Mass and then I did Bridge of Spies. So those two realities were so different from each other. And I feel like for a few months I lived within the thought process of Irish mob in Boston, and then the next thing that I enter is 1957 through 62, America, Germany, Russia, and it's just, it's a fascinating journey. I mean, it's like, it's, that's the privilege of our jobs, that we get to know intimately the world. And sometimes I was like, do I really need to know all the details about Whitey Bulger? I don't think so, but I do know it. Like, I know way too much about Whitey Bulger that I wish I knew, but that's what we do. We're like this like version of anthropologists, because to portray that world, you have to get to know that world really, really well.
When did you decide you wanted to be a costume designer?
When I realized that fashion school, I mean, I studied English studies and then I went to fashion school in New York. I realized that fashion is just, I could not justify the existence of fashion in my life. I just couldn't figure out how to fit in, because I realized that the concept of aesthetics being changed every half a year was just not motivating enough for me. Like, I believe in uniforms. I believe in repetition of your favorite things. I believe in loving the things that you have and making things last for years. I believe that it's disposability of fashion is immoral. So, I mean, for my sake.
Sure.
For my sake. Like, I do admire fashion. I do admire the thought and the courage and the aesthetics, but I just realized that world is not for me. And I had a lot of friends working in theater, and I asked them if they could introduce me to the theater, and that's how it started.
What did you have to do to train for the job?
I studied English studies, which basically, I studied English, British and American culture, history, literature, and I felt actually that gave me a great preparation of the general scope of understanding how the worlds work and how literature works and how, and I just knew so much about the culture of the United States, and that was like the entry to the United States. And then the fashion schooling gave me the just understanding of human silhouette and clothing on the human body. And then I did about 8 years of theater, and I did probably 200, 300 plays, and that was, I feel like, the training in action.
How did you break into the industry?
One of the plays did a short film with a director named Tony Gerber, who did a short film for a very avant-garde company, La Mama Theater in New York. And that director went on to directing his feature film, and I did the film with him, which was called Side Streets. And after that, this film director saw it, and we did Jesus' Son, which was still one of my favorite films. Bennett Miller saw that film, and he hired me on his first film, and that's just how it went, piece by piece.
How has your process changed throughout your career?
I feel like every time it's changing, because I'm learning new things. Like, I'm every time, like, if we're not learning, you might as well not be doing this job, because each time I'm like, before movie starts, I'm a bit nervous, like in this the most exciting way nervous. I was like, did I get it all? Do I have all the elements together? I mean, the one thing that I have to trust is my experience, and I learned how to trust it after many years, because I realized at a certain point that at the end of the year, I erase about 25,000 fitting photos from my computer. That's a lot of fitting photos. Like, one way or another, between commercials and films, you accumulate that many outfits. And I think after a while, it just becomes this language that you know really, really well of how things work on the human body. And it's interesting because it's clothing, but it's on three-dimensional figure, so it's complicated. But if you do it enough, like any other job, you become knowledgeable how to do it. So I trust that. So I'm never scared that I can't do it. It's just a question of how do you structure, because we have so many challenges, you know, like crazy challenges. How do you pull off dressing 4,000 people in three different countries? So you have to really, you know, assembling, first of all, it's not a solitary job. You have to have a great team. You're dead without a good team. You have no chance of pulling a job like this together. I mean, you might as well become, you know, a solo artist and endeavor on a painting career or photographic, or become a photographer. But it's, you just have to know how to work and collaborate with people, and you have to try to create the best teams possible, because that's really how those jobs happen.
What is the best advice you ever got about being a costume designer?
I feel like, I don't know, the way it worked for me, and there's different ways to do it, like everybody has a different way to do it. Like, some people love clothing. I love good stories. Like, I hate to say it, but like sometimes it's really not, it's for me, it's never clothing driven. It's driven by the materials that I'm drawn into. Is if it's a good story, it's a great process. If it's a great story to be told, you feel like you meet like-minded people, and you tell that story together, and that's what creates great work. So for me is making sure that when you find yourself in a room, you really spend time figuring out whether you connect with the person that you're going to spend the next 6 months with. Because I have been in situations that I didn't fully listen to my own feelings. And that once you experience once that kind of a connection that is not fully great, it's just very difficult process to work with people that you have different language with. I mean, not even different language, because different languages are exciting also to get to know. But if you are on the same train of thought.
100%. Last question for you. Memorable moments from filming Bridge of Spies. Is there a day or two that you will always remember 5, 10, 20 years from now?
I feel like I'll remember. I think I could probably say that I'll remember every single day on that film. Because that film was so exciting to make. Like, every day we would start really early and many times much earlier than the filming would start, because we had to have all those people ready, and then we had those incredible teams that were getting our people ready, and I would come sometimes in the middle of the process of that and go to a place where we were doing fittings, and you know, I worked between many different worlds of the set and preparation and filming. But every time I showed up on the set, I thought, oh my god, this is so incredible, this is such incredible filmmaking. And I always laughed with David Davenport, this phenomenal wardrobe supervisor, and I said, let's go to the set and let's see how those great movies are being made. Because each day was so exciting. So I can't quote one, because, I mean, the list is endless, like all those different worlds. And to see that movie being made was just phenomenal.
Actually, one last question. What are you doing next?
That's to be told. Like, I'm in the midst of meetings and reading scripts right now.
Standing there like that, you remind me of a man when I was young. Our house was overrun by border guards. And this man, my father's friend, he was beaten. Every time they hit him, he stood back up again. They hit him harder. Still, he got back to his feet. I think because of this, they let him live.
And I remind you of him?
Standing man. Standing man.